Your smart speaker. Shows out in the Angels doubleheader.
Shohei Ohtani has done it today in Detroit. His first major league shutout as Ohtani wins his ninth game of the season.
Joe Burrow gets carted off the practice field.
This is a team that is set to challenge the Kansas City Chiefs once again in the AFC for supremacy. And without Joe Burrow, that's an impossibility.
Sala claps back at Sean Payton.
Just say we got to get better as an organization because we weren't that good last year. We stunk up the place. You don't have to mention his name. You don't have to mention the New York Jets.
Plus, Dolphins star goes down in practice.
The unit doesn't completely fall apart without Jalen Ramsey. But let's also not get it twisted. There's no replacing a Jalen Ramsey.
And the Buffs say see you later to the Pac-12.
We feel strongly moving forward that the stability in the Big 12 will give us the platform we need to have success in the future.
This is SportsCenter All Night.
Well, I'm not going to acknowledge Sean on that. It's, you know, he's been in the league a while. He can say whatever the hell he wants. But as far as, you know, what we have going on here, I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping.
Here's Jim Basquiat.
On a day his new coach stands up to the arrows, Aaron Rodgers might be showing his worth to the Jets before taking a regular season snap and encouraging news concerning Bronny James. Welcome to SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. ESPN Radio is presented by Progressive Insurance. It's the time of year where training camps are just getting underway in the NFL, while Major League Baseball is nearing its trade deadline, where teams have to hold them or fold them. The Angels are clearly the former, pushing all their chips to the center of the table.
Shohei Ohtani, his first major league shutout. Fly ball, it's hit well out into left center, and that one is out of here. This Thursday afternoon in Detroit has been showtime.
Yeah, by now you know the Angels are not dealing pending free agent Shohei Ohtani, with GM Perry Minasian saying, we are going to roll the dice and see what happens. What happened on Thursday was pretty special, as baseball's best player again showed why on the mound and with the bat.
Here's the next delivery, and Shohei lifts a high fly ball. It's hit well out into left center, and that one is out of here. Boy, oh boy, this Thursday afternoon in Detroit has been showtime as Ohtani connects 37th home run of the season. Here's Shohei swinging and lifting another ball high and deep, and that one is in right center, and that one is gone. Ohtani with a two-homer game right now. He has 38 for the season.
Yeah, that was game two against the Tigers. Ohtani hitting two home runs to increase his major league leading total to 38, clearing the fences a pair of times in an 11-4 win before leaving the game with cramps. In the opener, he got the ball on the mound and finished what he started.
And the 3-1 pitch. And this is lifted high in the air. It's hit well into center field, but making the running catch about 7 or 8 feet from the rim of the track is the center fielder, Mickey Moniak. And Shohei Ohtani has done it today in Detroit. His first major league shutout, as Ohtani wins his ninth game of the season.
And the calls on Angels Radio AM 830. Ohtani threw a one-hit shutout, his first complete game in the bigs, as the Angels beat the Tigers 6-0 in what amounted to a doubleheader sweep fueled by Ohtani. He became the first major league player to throw a shutout in one game of a doubleheader, hit a home run, much less two, in the other. His skipper, Phil Nevin, on what it impresses him so much about his star.
You know, we tried to not to take for granted what we have in him. You hate to say that, like, you expect greatness every day, just because, but it's what we get, and it's awesome to watch. The thing is that him performing at this level, when there's so much focus on one person to be great and continue to be great as he does, only the mentally strong are able to do that. And And that's what impresses me most about him. So, I mean, obviously you guys talk about him every day and it's on TV every day and the fans come to see him every day. And to still be able to perform the way he does, it's mind-boggling, the mental toughness that he has to be able to do this.
Yeah, yes, they know their two-way superstar is a free agent with no guarantees he'll re-sign with the Angels, but they sent a message not only to their fans but their players, specifically Ohtani, that they are in a win-now mode after acquiring right-handers Lucas Giolito and Ronaldo Lopez from the White Sox. Their GM on that message.
As far as messages go, I just think it's improving the roster, which I've tried to do since I've gotten here. So, you know, we feel like there's an opportunity to win and to play well going forward. We're going to roll the dice and see what happens.
Yeah, and Aldin Gonzalez on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on the Angels' chances to keep them this postseason.
I know there are a lot of people from the outside that completely discount the Angels' chances of bringing him back, and I understand why. I mean, this is a franchise that, even though they've had two generational players in Mike Trout and Shohei Ohtani, haven't done any meaningful winning in a really long time. So it's easy to see why you'd be skeptical, but the Angels feel like they have a chance. They feel like they have a chance because of his familiarity with the organization, because they helped him. They helped groom him into becoming a successful two-way player because they give him so much autonomy. He basically does whatever he wants. He runs his own program. And just the comfort of playing for the Angels, I'm not saying that that's going to sway him in free agency, especially when so many teams are going to be committing so much money to sign him. But they feel like at the very least, they have a chance, or more of a chance than maybe people on the outside believe they might have.
Yeah, and keep this in mind. They have won 9 of 11 games, aiming for their first playoff appearance since 2014. They're expecting to get Mike Trout back, and he and their skipper, Phil Nevin, all about going for it, which may not only be good for the Angels, but also good for the game of baseball.
Yeah, it's exciting. I mean, I think it's a different buzz in the room today, and obviously, it helps us quite a bit. I mean, two quality arms and established starter that's, you know, at the top of a lot of rotations. But really, the buzz in the room and the feeling, you know, in the front office when the ownership is really bought into what we've got here, believes in us, believes in the players, the staff. It's a great feeling to have.
Been saying it since the beginning of the year. You know, the front office wants to win. You see, the Perry's working some magic over there, and you know, Artie's, you know, agreeing with it. So it's a good message for the guys. You know, the message has been the same all year. We're in it till, you know, we're not. So it's going to keep pushing forward, see how it goes.
Bengals quarterback Joe Burrow was carted off the practice field today after what appeared to be a non-contact injury.
These things can range from days to multiple weeks.
You have to wonder if we'll see Burrow again before his name gets signed.
Yeah, concerning news to the Bengals as QB Joe Burrow carted off the practice field Thursday, came up hobbling from a scramble. The franchise signal caller on one leg as he went to the ground with a play near the end of their afternoon practice. He was wearing a sleeve on it and limping. Coach Zach Taylor said later it was a calf injury. Here's more from the Bengals coach.
This is football. Guys go down with an injury that maybe is a day thing. Who knows? So we don't message the team after every single person goes down. There's a lot of guys that had soreness today that's cut down a little bit. So that's just part of playing football in general.
Yeah, source telling ESPN's Ben Baby that an early assessment indicates it's a calf strain. WCPO-TV's Caleb No on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on the initial reaction when Burrow went down.
You see that guy at the face of the franchise go down, you talk about a hush over the practice facility. You can, it kind of went in waves because it's a large, there's like two full football fields side by side there. So some of the fans are, I mean, you're talking 75 yards away from where it happened, but you could tell that slowly it kind of worked its way around and people realized Joe Burrow is on the ground and he's getting, being put on a cart and being carted off the field. What I will remember about right after it happened was there was somebody behind me and they were screaming, no, 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 because like people understand what this guy's been to, but they also understand what he means to this organization and the franchise and the team.
ESPN injury analyst Stefania Bell on Canny and Carlin.
You really need to get specifics on the degree of injury when you start talking timetables, and that's something we just can't tell from a distance. But, you know, he definitely felt a pretty good pull there. But these things can range from days, 5 to 7 days for a mild injury, to multiple weeks if it's something more severe.
Again, keep in mind, Burrow in contract discussions with the Bengals on a deal that could make him the highest paid player in the league. Ryan Clark on NFL Live.
If Coach Taylor is correct and it's a calf injury, then both Joe Burrow and the Cincinnati Bengals are so lucky. But when you're somebody like Joe, who is on the precipice of the largest contract in football history, in NFL history, not just for the position, but in total, you're scared. You want to make sure that you're healthy. And if you're the Cincinnati Bengals, you want to make sure your franchise player is ready to go going forward. But for the immediate, this is a team that is set to challenge the Kansas City Chiefs once again in the AFC for supremacy. And without Joe Burrow, that's an impossibility.
Along those lines, Adam Schefter on what we can expect regarding Burrow on the field.
The backdrop to all this, of course, is that Joe Burrow is on the verge of becoming the highest paid player in NFL history. At some point, the two sides are going to try to get that deal done. And you have to wonder now, with Joe Burrow's agent also representing Nick Bosa, who didn't even show to the 49ers training camp and won't show until he gets a new contract, if we won't see Joe Burrow back on a practice field again until he does become the highest paid player in NFL history. But for now, it looks like a calf injury. Calf injuries usually sideline players multiple weeks, but mixed in with the backdrop of his unsettled contract situation, you have to wonder if we'll see Burrow again before his name gets signed.
As far as, you know, what we have going on here, I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping. So hate away. Obviously, we're doing something right if you got to talk about us when we don't play you till week four.
Sean Payton's not shy about letting people know how he feels about things. If he gets asked a question, he's going to answer it bluntly. And I think that's what he was doing while also sending a message to everybody within his organization about what the culture is going to be moving forward.
For a guy like Sean Payton, it was a small move by him. You don't have to mention his name. You don't have to mention the New York Jets.
Yeah, Broncos head coach Sean Payton unleashing criticisms on his predecessor, Nathaniel Hackett, and his new team, Hackett's new team, the New York Jets. In an interview with the USA Today Sports, Payton called the work done by Hackett and his staff in 2022 one of the worst coaching jobs in the history of the NFL. The Broncos went 5-12 in Russell Wilson's first season in Denver. He had a career worst season, including just 16 touchdowns and a league-high 55 sacks. Payton also took aim at Hackett's new employer, the New York Jets, saying they are spending a lot of time trying to win the offseason with a lot of pomp and circumstance, to which Jets coach Robert Saleh responded.
Well, I'm not going to acknowledge Sean on that. It's, you know, he's been in the league a while. He can say whatever the hell he wants. But as far as, you know, what we have going on here, I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping. So hate away. Obviously, we're doing something right if you got to talk about us when we don't play you till week four. You know, the guys in our locker room, they've earned everything that's coming to them and really excited about what's going on. I think Hackett's doing a phenomenal job here. The coaching staff is doing a phenomenal job, and we're focused on us. I get it. There's a lot of external noise. There's a lot of people who are hating on us. There's a lot of people looking for us to fail. There's a lot of crows pecking at our neck. But all you can do is spread your wings, keep flying high until those crows fall off and suffocate from the inability to breathe. But really, really, really excited about the group we have, the coaching that's going on. But I'm going to keep our focus on us and making sure that we're prepared every single day to do the best we can and learn from our past and grow with every moment that we have.
There you have it from Saleh. They are popping, not pumping, right? More NFL talk this morning. ESPN Radio in the morning. ESPN Radio, ESPN 2. Harry Douglas, Amber Wilson, joined by Mike Tannenbaum at 7 Eastern. Buster only talking baseball with the deadline coming upon us. And Marcel Louis-Jacques, ESPN NFL Nation Dolphins reporter on at 8:30 Eastern. Good news from Bronny James. He has been discharged from Cedars-Sinai Medical Center and is resting at home 3 days after the 18-year-old son of LeBron James went into cardiac arrest. The hospital said they're hopeful for his continued progress, encouraged by his response, resilience, and his family and community support. LeBron took to social media to thank well-wishers, noting everyone is doing great. Coming up, Colorado going back to where they began. Details ahead and the trade deadline near. New York Mets have begun their sell-off. We'll tell you the deal on deck. This is SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio.
Yo, it's Jay Williams. Coming up Friday, I'll tell you which NFL team is being overlooked right now. And just a hint, they recently won the Super Bowl. Don't miss it, 6 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Radio, ESPN2, and ESPNU.
This is SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio.
Wall Street Journal Radio is now on TuneIn. From top-line morning briefings to afternoon deep dives on the markets, the economy, and more, invest in your day with WSJ Radio.
I'm J.R. Whalen for the Wall Street Journal. Many workers have high expectations for raises.
Discover business news and analysis for the decisions that matter from sources you can trust. The Wall Street Journal, Barron's, MarketWatch, and Investor's Business Daily. It's all here, now streaming on TuneIn. Search Wall Street Journal Radio on TuneIn to listen.
It's time for the music that's trending on TuneIn.
Mama's Boy by...
Hi, I'm Dominic Fike.
Now playing an alt-hits.
Alt-hits.
This music and more on TuneIn. Discover your new favorite sound today.
All the hits. Your country music playlist.
More music, more fun.
Only the classic hits.
Radio has the power to transport you around the world. And now we've got a new way to discover new stations. Say hello to TuneIn Explorer, our map-based view that shows you where your favorite stations and podcasts broadcast from. From local faves to far-flung gems, it's the new way to blaze your own trail in listening. Ready to set out? Just click on the radio tab to plot your own course.
Instead of fly ball to left back, onto the track.
Hey, baseball fans, this is Buster Olney of the Baseball Tonight podcast. The MLB season is now playing on TuneIn Premium, featuring live home calls of every Major League Baseball team. Only TuneIn Premium gives you access to blackout-free coverage at home or on the road, from walk-off home runs to no-hitters.
He's done it, Phil Cross! The eighth no-hitter in history!
All the way through the World Series. Search MLB to start listening.
Wall Street Journal Radio is now streaming commercial-free on TuneIn Premium. From top-line morning briefings to afternoon deep dives on the markets, the economy, and more, invest in your day with WSJ Radio.
I'm J.R. Whalen for the Wall Street Journal.
Discover business news and analysis for the decisions that matter from sources you can trust. The Wall Street Journal, Barron's, MarketWatch, and Investor's Business Daily.
50% of the S&P 500's performance.
Just upgrade to premium to get your daily business news without the ads.
On this week's On the Media, tales from the trenches of the digital news business. A failure, a success, and a couple of hopefuls.
As the editor-in-chief of Defector told me, when you aren't determined to grow at a rapid pace and you aren't beholden to corporate bosses, running a media company really isn't that complicated.
Don't miss this week's On the Media from WNYC.
Listen to the On the Media podcast on TuneIn today.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that our daughters have what they need to grow and learn. But that isn't the case for nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. that struggle with hunger.
Childhood hunger is a heartbreaking reality that Feeding America is working to change. Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste and provides it to families and children in need.
You can help kids in need in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Did you know you can use AirPlay and Chromecast to listen on connected devices? Tap on the device icon from the Now Playing screen on the TuneIn app and listen to all your favorite stations like Today's Hits,
I can buy myself flowers,
Latin Hits, Country Roads,
I'm 23 and there ain't nobody who can drink like me,
and more.
I smell sex and candy, yeah.
To protect her home and family in a disaster, Karen was willing to wade through.
We'll be right back.
This is SportsCenter all night on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app.
Here's Jim Pasquale.
Yeah, we're back on SportsCenter all night with the Buffs shuffling back to where they began.
The University of Colorado leaving the Pac-12 for the Big 12. The move will happen after next season.
We looked at it from a lot of lenses. First and foremost, what we felt was best for our student athletes certainly was a consideration as well.
Yeah, the Colorado Board of Regents voting unanimously Thursday to leave the Pac-12 conference and return to the Big 12. The move will come after the 23-24 campaign. Colorado's departure will coincide with the end of the Pac-12 television deal, which means Colorado won't have to pay any exit fee. Athletic Director Rick George on the factors that led to this move.
One of the key, you know, like I said, there's a number of factors on why we made this transition, or we will be making this transition. One of them had to do with stability. And we feel strongly moving forward that the stability in the Big 12 will give us the platform we need to have success in the future.
Yeah, well, how about this? The Pac-12 has seemed vulnerable to potential poaching. They will lose USC and UCLA to the Big Ten next year. They spend months trying to land a new TV rights contract. Does this trigger conferences beyond the Big 12 to target Pac-12 schools? Pete Thamel, Max Olson, and Dan Murphy on what's next for both conferences, beginning with that Pac-12.
If you're Oregon and Washington, what is the benefit of expanding? Because when you expand, you have to slice the monetary pie up more. So it's probably a longer answer than you wanted. But I would say San Diego State would be the Vegas odds favorite to go to the Pac-12. And of the remaining Pac-12 schools who could go to the Big 12, Arizona would be the likely favorite to go next.
The biggest question looming for the Pac-12 and Big 12 are about what, if any, chain reactions may follow Colorado's move. Arizona, Arizona State, Utah, and UConn have all been reported as potential targets to follow the Buffaloes to the Big 12. With three of those four schools coming from the Pac-12, the West Coast League's very future may hinge on how quickly they can find some stability and keep their current members happy with a lucrative TV deal.
Big 12 doesn't want to just stay at 13, you know, when in 24, when Oklahoma and Texas are gone. I think the Big 12 wants to add one more and at least be at 14. I would imagine the focus is going to be on Arizona going forward here. And they've had conversations with Arizona over the course of the past year. I think it's no secret that's been a target for them. You know, I talked to their president, Bobby Robbins, yesterday, and they're staying firm in their stance at Arizona that they want to see what the new Pac-12 TV rights contract looks like. They want to see what the offer is. They're saying, show me the money to George Kliavkoff. And so the sooner that happens, the sooner Arizona can figure out where they need to be. I think Robbins prefers to be in the Pac-12, but you know, ultimately he needs to see a TV deal that's acceptable. So I think that's the one to really keep an eye on here.
More conversations on ESPN Radio in the morning on the various storylines around college football. Adam Rittenberg joins the show at 8:15 Eastern. Harry Douglas, Amber Wilson in the seat. You're listening to SportsCenter all night on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. The Major League Baseball trade deadline comes Tuesday. The New York Mets have finally looked in the mirror, realizing they have to sell. They've agreed to a trade to send closer David Robertson to the Marlins for a pair of minor leaguers. Robertson has 14 saves this year, an ERA just past 2 for a Mets team that's 6 games under 500, and that includes Thursday's comeback win.
Here's the pitch. Swinging a liner in the air to right, that should get the go-ahead run home. Thomas near the line makes the catch. Alonso tags, coming to the plate, the throw to the plate, head first slide. He scores, and the Mets take the lead.
Howie Rose, the call on WCBS. Mets 2 in the 8th. Mark Canna sack fly gets them the 2-1 win over the Nationals. Canna among several other Mets who could be on the move in the coming days. Yan Gomes drove in 3 runs. Cubs get back to 500. Their 6th straight win, beating the Cardinals 10-3 in a game that got testy.
Here comes the 2-0. Swing and a miss. Actually a foul tip, and that took a bite out of Wilson Contreras. Contreras is hurt. He is holding his head up near the right ear, and now he waves off the trainer, but that nailed him in the mask, Ron, and seemed to pinch part of the mask into his head, I think.
Yeah, as heard on the Cubs radio network, Cubs outfielder Ian Happ bloodied St. Louis catcher Wilson Contreras when he hit him in the head with a long follow-through on the swing Then he himself was soon hit by pitcher Miles Michaelis as things got testy in the very first frame of that game. Dodgers could be after another bat and target a member of the Cardinals, so says Aldin Gonzalez, who is on Freddie and Fitzsimmons.
Nolan Arenado has been a name that's been thrown out there. He would waive his no-trade clause to play for the Dodgers, but people believe that it's unlikely that the Cardinals trade him. We'll see. The Dodgers have the type of pitching that could sway a team like the Cardinals to give up a franchise cornerstone like Nolan Arenado.
Yeah, that would be a big add to their lineup. The Brewers adding one bat as well. Carlos Santana from the Pirates. He has 12 long balls, 53 knocked in. Will fill in at first base for Rowdy Tellez. Back on the field.
Here it comes. Breaking ball, tap back to the mound, and on through. It trickles into shallow center after hitting the second base bag. Scoring is Jimenez, and racing to second with a hustle double. On a dribbler back through the box is Josh Naylor. 5-3 Cleveland.
1100 WTAM, Josh Naylor drove in three. Guardians double the White Sox 6-3. Terry Francona tied Casey Stengel, 13th place on baseball's career wins list. 1,926 career W's. Buster only talking baseball. ESPN Radio in the morning at 7:45 Eastern. Coming up, reaction to Sean Payton ripping the Jets. That's next. This is ESPN Radio.
Greeny.
If being on Hard Knocks creates any problems for this team, then they were going to have them anyway. You are the most interesting team in the NFL, and the Jets should embrace that.
Weekday mornings at 10 Eastern on ESPN Radio.
Next time on the New Yorker Radio Hour, the biographer of atomic scientist Robert Oppenheimer, the subject of Christopher Nolan's new film.
He feared that if the war ended without the use of this weapon, the next war was going to be fought by two nuclear armed adversaries, and it would be Armageddon.
Oppenheimer's biographer Kai Bird, next time on the New Yorker Radio Hour. Listen to this episode of the New Yorker Radio Hour on TuneIn today.
Country music is all about history, and TuneIn's Vintage Country Channel brings you the best songs of country's past all day long. So you can go old school with classics from Hank Williams, Willie Nelson, Patsy Cline, and more, so you can pay homage to the classic songs that made country music so timeless. Just search Vintage Country on TuneIn for just the classics.
Hi, I'm Danica Patrick. Watching my nieces grow, play, and learn is amazing, but not every child gets to be carefree. 1 in 6 kids in the U.S. are hungry. This breaks my heart, and it's something that Feeding America is working to change. Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste and gives it to families in need. To help, visit feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
TuneIn's Poolside Station is your one-stop shop for pool party playlists. And now you can keep those good vibes going uninterrupted by going commercial-free. It's as easy as signing up for a TuneIn Premium plan. Then, you'll be pumping Diplo, Purple Disco Machine, Disclosure, and more through your speakers with absolutely no ads. With TuneIn Premium, the party never stops. Just upgrade today to get started.
Your one-stop shop for baseball.
And a curveball smacked into left center field.
Football.
Galloping down the sidelines. Touchdown.
Hockey.
Chance here on the break-in. Kuznetsov fires. Scores!
Basketball.
Randall. Step back three. Bang!
Soccer.
It's a Messi! Clear away across the line.
And all your favorite sports. Oh, and we can't forget sports talk. We are TuneIn Radio.
Did you know you can use AirPlay and Chromecast to listen on connected devices? Tap on the device icon from the now playing screen on the TuneIn app and listen to all your favorite stations like today's hits, Latin hits, country roads, and more.
I smell sex and
to protect her home and family in a disaster, Karen was willing to wade through water, mud, and insurance paperwork.
Yeah, I can do this.
You go, Karen! By simply understanding and updating what her insurance covers and doesn't cover now, she'll be better prepared no matter when disaster strikes. Learn other simple ways to protect your home and family before a natural disaster at ready.gov. That's ready.gov. A message from FEMA and the Ad Council.
2024 is coming, and the race for the White House is already underway. Get the latest news from the team you trust, such as CNN.
We are not in that ballpark. 219th, 216th, leading right now.
Fox News Radio.
You could take the five worst presidents. They would not have done the damage.
MSNBC.
12 million new jobs. More jobs in 2 years than any president created in a four-year term.
And more with the facts you won't hear anywhere else. Hear the news you trust on TuneIn.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that our daughters have what they need to grow and learn. But that isn't...
This is SportsCenter all night on ESPN Radio and on the ESPN app. Here's Jim Basquiat.
And ESPN Radio is presented by Progressive Insurance. Insurance for motorcycles, boats, and RVs for protection on the road and on the water. See how much you can save at 1-800-PROGRESSIVE and progressive.com.
Half hour headlines on SportsCenter all night.
Again, our top story. Shohei has himself a day on the mound and with the bat, a doubleheader sweep. Bengals quarterback Joe Burrow carted off the field with a calf injury. Sean Payton has harsh words about his predecessor and the New York Jets. Colorado leaving the pack at 12 to return to the Big 12. And the New York Mets trade closer David Robertson to the Marlins.
Shohei Ohtani has done it today in Detroit. His first major league shutout. Fly ball. It's hit well out into left center, and that one is out of here. Boy, oh boy, this Thursday afternoon in Detroit has been showtime. Another ball high and deep, and that one is in right center, and that one is gone. Ohtani with a two-homer game right now. He has 38 for the season.
And a doubleheader sweep at the Tigers. Shohei Ohtani threw a one-hit shutout in his first complete game in the majors in the opener, then became the first major league player to throw a shutout in one game of a doubleheader and hit a home run. But in this case, he had two in the other game. Keep in mind, the team has made it clear they're not trading the pending free agent. His skipper, Phil Nevin, on Shohei's stellar day.
What a volume today for him. You know, as I've said many times, certainly something I've never seen. I'm not sure at any level what he did in the first game, obviously, with the complete game, two home runs in the second game. But important two wins for us. We know it's lying ahead. Proud of the guys for just staying focused on today. So it's a good day for us.
Bengals quarterback Joe Burrow was carted off the practice field today after what appeared to be a non-contact injury to his lower right leg.
These things can range from days, 5 to 7 days for a mild injury, to multiple weeks if it's something more severe.
Calf injuries usually sideline players multiple weeks, but mixed in with the backdrop of his unsettled contract situation, you have to wonder if we'll see Burrow again before his name gets signed.
Yeah, Joe Burrow carted off the field Thursday, a source telling Ben Baby. The early assessment indicates it's a calf strain. Remember, Burrow in contract discussions with the Bengals on a deal that could make him the highest paid player in the NFL. Caleb Noah of WCPO-TV, the ABC affiliate in Cincinnati, on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on how those negotiations could impact this team.
Joe Burrow doesn't strike me as the kind of guy, the kind of person, and human being to let the contract extension, you know, or the potential contract extension become an issue. There was already an agreement made between the Bengals on the Bengals side of things and Joe Burrow and his agent, so their side of things, that the contract extension would not play out publicly and in the media's eye, that it would all be done privately, quietly. And Joe Burrow himself even said on Wednesday that that's how he feels business should be done. So according to everything Joe Burrow has said, everything the Bengals have said, and everything I know about this, I would be surprised if this contract extension situation gets in the way of
what the Bengals are trying to do, and that's win a Super Bowl for the first time in franchise history.
I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping, so hate away.
If he gets asked a question, he's going to answer it bluntly. And I think that's what he was doing while also sending a message to everybody within his organization.
For a guy like Sean Payton, it was a small move by him.
Well, 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 Broncos coach Sean Payton unleashing criticism on his predecessor, Nathaniel Hackett, and the New York Jets. In an interview with USA Today Sports, Payton called the work done by Hackett and his staff in 2022 one of the worst coaching jobs in the history of the NFL. He also noted there were 20 dirty hands around quarterback Russell Wilson's career worst season last year, which included 16 touchdowns and a league-high 55 sacks. He also took aim at Hackett's new employer, the Jets, saying they are spending a lot of time trying to win the offseason with a lot of pomp and circumstance. Tim Hasselbeck, Chris Canty, Harry Douglas on Payton's criticism.
For a guy like Sean Payton, it was a small move by him, and I have no issue with him talking about his own team because that's his team now, right? And he has to get those guys up to a winning coach or something that he's accustomed and used to. But when you go to mentioning the New York Jets and Nathaniel Hackett, and I understand he was the head coach of that team last year, but he's no longer there. He's somewhere else. He's in another place. Just say we got to get better as an organization because we weren't that good last year. We stunk up the place. You don't have to mention his name. You don't have to mention the New York Jets. So I thought that was a small move by Sean Payton.
Sean Payton's not shy about letting people know how he feels about things. If he gets asked a question, he's going to answer it bluntly. And I think that's what he was doing while also sending a message to everybody within his organization about what the culture is going to be moving forward. Because remember, some of those bad actors that played a role in how that Broncos season came off the rails last year, like, they're still there. And so I think this is Sean Payton setting the tone and using the Jets as an example to do it with all of the hoopla around that squad. So it's not something that we typically see from current head coaches, but this doesn't surprise me coming from Sean Payton.
What he was saying to his football team basically was, what you did last year doesn't work. I've won a lot in this league. I know how it works. I know how it's going to be done in all aspects, what you do in the training room, et cetera. And so I'm going to go after Nathaniel Hackett and what went on here before. And what I'm doing by doing that is talking to my team. Now, I think the thing that's alarming about it, or I guess shocking, is that there's a coach's fraternity. That stuff doesn't typically happen. But I think with Payton and everything he's accomplished, he probably felt like, you know, it was something he could do.
Now, keep in mind, the Broncos went 5-12 in Wilson's first season in Denver. Now, speaking of the Jets, Aaron Rodgers took a $35 million pay cut with a restructured deal he signed Wednesday. That financial flexibility will allow the Jets to pursue free agents, including Dalvin Cook, who will make a visit this weekend. Rodgers coach Robert Saleh.
Like I said, we'll never say no to a great player if the opportunity presents itself in the right way. So excited about him and his visit. It's really just being able to have a conversation, get hands on him. I know he's got some things that medically that would have to check out and all that stuff. But again, excited about his visit and the chance to sit down and talk with him. He's dynamic. He's a dynamic ball carrier. He's been a dynamic ball carrier for a long time. He's great in the pass game. And so it's just a matter of, like I said, of all the details of that. I'm not going to get too detailed, but you can't say no to a good football player. They usually find a way.
Yeah, Diana Rossini, though, on the impact Rodgers is having on this Jets team off the field.
Everyone sounds so refreshed and so confident. And, you know, in the NFL, nobody ever wants to give away or make predictions of what they can be. And I haven't had anyone say to me, like, man, we're going to go so deep. We're so good. No one has shared that type of thought yet. But I can tell that the Aaron Rodgers presence, winning way, attention to detail, discipline has become a contagious characteristic within the building.
Dolphins star cornerback Jalen Ramsey will undergo surgery on the meniscus in his left knee, expected to miss the start of the regular season. His ACL is intact. Marcel Louis-Jacques covers the Dolphins for ESPN on potential replacements.
They do have some cornerback depth. They still have another former All-Pro in Xavien Howard. He's been a Pro Bowler each of the past 3 years, 4 total overall in his career. He's finally healthy after dealing with some soft tissue injuries the past couple years. He is still a number one corner. After that, it's a lot of youth. Guys like Kader Kohu, undrafted free agent from last year. You know, he's great as a rookie. Then they've got the second round pick, Cam Smith, out of South Carolina. Rookie. So don't expect, you know, don't expect all pro right away. He still has some things to learn as we're watching him here in training camp, but he's going to be thrust into some action almost right away. Then they still have 2020 first round pick, Noah Igbinoghene. He's playing for a roster spot. He's going to have the camp of his life now, and he could challenge for some play time if he does. Keon Crossan as well, coming back from injury. Nick Needham coming back from injury. There are guys on this team. They don't completely, the unit doesn't completely fall apart without Jalen Ramsey, but let's also not get it twisted. There's no replacing a Jalen Ramsey. He's the best cornerback in the league, arguably.
Saquon Barkley and the Giants agreeing to terms on a one-year deal worth up to $11 million. This is a running back issue. This isn't a Saquon Barkley issue.
You get 27, 28 years of age. As far as they're concerned, you're a senior citizen at the running back position.
They will look at him and say, you know what? The more we play you, the more used goods you become.
One of these guys needs to win so that they can prove to general managers you can pay a running back and still build a Super Bowl-winning roster.
Saquon Barkley following his heart in signing his franchise tag and joining the Giants on a revised contract that will pay him $11 million over 1 year. Tuesday, Barkley explained why he altered his stance.
I had an epiphany. No, the reality of it is one, I kind of just followed my heart. Obviously, I heard what everyone was saying in the news or social media, but I kind of just followed my heart. You know, you got to look at it as a business point. From a business view, I felt like what's the best thing that I can do. Some people may agree or disagree with this, and you know, sit out or sit in. And I feel like for this year specifically, the best thing that I can do for myself would be coming back, going out there, play the game that I love, playing for my teammates, doing something I want to do since I was a little kid. And I understand, I know what's going on with the running back situation and me being tagged and the value of the running back continue going down. Only way that's going to change, someone got to make a change.
Were you seriously considering sitting out of camp and maybe even part of the regular season?
Yeah, I was. That's a play that I have. But I'll be completely honest. If I sat out this year and say if the New York Football Giants and I sat out and we didn't have a good record, you think that's going to make another team in free agency or the Giants want to have me come back the next year after I sat out a whole year and be like, oh, we want to give you $15 million a year now. Like, I don't think that's how it's going to work. And after, you know, having conversations and really breaking it down, when you sit there and you break it down like that, you're like, the only way that I'm going to make a change or do something that's going to, you know, benefit for myself and my family is doing what I do best. And that's showing up, playing the game I love.
More NFL conversation, ESPN Radio in the morning. Harry Douglas, Amber Wilson, joined by Mike Tenenbaum at 7 Eastern. Marcel Louis-Jacques talking Dolphins at 8:30 Eastern. ESPN Radio and ESPN2. Our run-through NFL cast with 2 days with the focus on the Saints and Raiders.
Hey, let's go do our job, man.
NFL Nation 2-A-Days. Time is here. On ESPN Radio. The Las Vegas Raiders.
458.
This is Raiders reporter Paul Gutierrez, and the biggest storyline for Las Vegas wonders if Jimmy Garoppolo is an upgraded quarterback over Derek Carr. The Raiders believe so. Otherwise, they would not have cut a 9-year starter and signed the oft-injured Garoppolo. The thinking is a healthy Garoppolo is indeed an upgrade in this offensive system, and his familiarity with Coach Josh McDaniel's scheme from their time together in New England. Granted, they were last together in 2017, but using Jarrett Stidham as an example, Stidham looked more comfortable in his 2 starts to end last season than Carr did in 15 games. Remember, McDaniel's scheme was the only one Stidham had known since entering the NFL in 2019. If familiarity breeds contempt, the Raiders hope it also brings success.
Countdown to kickoff with NFL Nation 2-A-Days on ESPN Radio.
Hey, let's go do our job, man.
NFL Nation 2-A-Days.
Time is here.
On ESPN Radio. The New Orleans Saints.
158!
This is Catherine Terrell covering the Saints. The focus will be on wide receiver Michael Thomas for the 3rd straight training camp. Ankle and toe injuries have limited Thomas to only 10 regular season games since the 2020 season opener. Getting the 2019 Offensive Player of the Year back to full health would be a huge boost to the Saints. While Thomas hasn't officially practiced yet this year, it's been all positive progress off the field as he and new quarterback Derek Carr have already hit it off. The Saints and second-year head coach Dennis Allen are counting on this tandem to turn their hopes around after they finished 22nd in scoring offense last year and missed the playoffs for the second straight season.
Countdown to kickoff with NFL Nation Two-A-Days on ESPN Radio.
The NCAA and Michigan are negotiating a four-game suspension for head coach Jim Harbaugh for recruiting violations.
The main thing here is that Harbaugh was either uncooperative or misleading in his interviews with NCAA investigators.
Yeah, Big Ten Media Day came Thursday. Michigan coach Jim Harbaugh facing a four-game suspension tied to the NCAA recruiting investigation, in which Harbaugh faces violation for not cooperating with NCAA enforcement, to which he addressed that on Thursday.
Right. So as you probably already know, I mean, I can't, not allowed to talk about any aspect of that ongoing situation. I'm with you. I mean, I'd love to lay it all out there. Nothing to be ashamed of. But now is not that time. And that's about all there is to say about that.
Meantime, we keep it with the conference, and a fifth former football player files suit against Northwestern. Simba Short, a linebacker for the team in 2015 and 2016 before he medically retired, alleges he was sexually and mentally abused while in the program that has since fired coach Pat Fitzgerald. Minnesota coach PJ Fleck brushing off allegations that he runs a toxic program on Thursday, saying they mostly come from players and employees who have been dismissed or departed on their own. Coming up, we size up the next challenge for the U.S. women at the World Cup and have the night's top plays all queued up, and that has a Shohei flair. That's next. This is SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio.
Yo, it's Jay Williams. Coming up on Friday, we continue our ESPN Radio Two-A-Days with the Panthers. Bryce Young is officially the starter, but is that the right decision? Don't miss it, 6 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Radio, ESPN2, and ESPNU.
ESPN Radio Sports Center All Night. More next.
Ah, now that's a vibe. That's a vibe. Timmins curated Chill Station brings you nonstop good vibes from the best chill electronic artists and producers, so you can find your chill all day long. Think low tempo remixes, laid back takes on pop classics, and so much more. Just search Chill on TuneIn to listen.
Wall Street Journal Radio is now on TuneIn. From top-line morning briefings to afternoon deep dives on the markets, the economy, and more, invest in your day with WSJ Radio.
I'm J.R. Whelan for the Wall Street Journal. Many workers have high expectations for raises.
Discover business news and analysis for the decisions that matter from sources you can trust. The Wall Street Journal, Barron's, MarketWatch, and Investor's Business Daily. It's all here, now streaming on TuneIn. Search Wall Street Journal Radio on TuneIn to listen.
Did you know you can use AirPlay and Chromecast to listen on connected devices? Tap on the device icon from the Now Playing screen on the TuneIn app and listen to all your favorite stations like Today's Hits, Latin Hits, Country Roads, and more.
I smell sex and candy. Yeah.
I'm World Cup champion Megan Klingenberg. Wondering who you should root for at the FIFA Women's World Cup? I'm hosting a new podcast, My New Favorite Futbolista, where I will introduce you to soccer's brightest stars and the causes they are championing. From the 22-year-old American phenom speaking out about student-athlete mental health,
I try to just like approach everything with like you don't know what someone's going through,
to the U.S. defender who travels to tournaments with her young son.
Am I ever going to be able to run for 5 minutes straight?
Listen to My New Favorite Futbolista.
With the pennant race heating up, you won't want to miss a single moment of the action. From now until the World Series, TuneIn has you covered with play-by-play coverage of every game.
And that one's hit well, deep in the left field.
So what are you waiting for? Don't sit on the sidelines. Get in the game with TuneIn's live MLB coverage.
To the track, to the wall, and it's gone! A game-winning home run!
All you have to do is search for MLB or tell your device to play your favorite team on TuneIn, and you'll be on your way to the ballpark.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that our daughters have what they need to grow and learn.
But that isn't the case for nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. that struggle with hunger.
Childhood hunger is a heartbreaking reality that Feeding America is working to change. Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste and provides it to families and children in need.
You can help kids in need in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
The TuneIn app is the most convenient way to access all your favorite audio on the go. Download the TuneIn.
This is Sports Center All Night on ESPN Radio. Here's Jim Basquiat.
Yeah, we're back on SportsCenter All Night with the Women's World Cup. Argentina and South Africa draw, while Nigeria and Portugal are winners. The latter is next up for the Americans, coming off that draw with the Netherlands. ESPN FC reporter Alexis Nunez looks ahead.
Heading into their final group game of the World Cup, the U.S. Women's National Team should be feeling pretty decent about where they are. They're still in the driver's seat to win the group, but their overall performance in front of goal just isn't quite there yet. For the second match in a row, we're talking about goals that could have been against the Netherlands. They had 18 shots at goal, but only four of them were actually on target. But for players like Alex Morgan and Julie Ertz, they're not hitting the panic button just yet.
I'm feeling good. It's coming, and I'm just being patient with it and trying to do as much as I can to put myself and Soph and Trin in goal scoring positions, and got myself in some of those positions today, but now it's all about putting them back in the net.
I think it's just kind of how the tournament goes. You kind of build into a tournament. That's what you want to do, and you want to keep getting better and better. And we have the most faith into our forwards. They're world class, and so we'll get them.
Well, another question surrounding the Americans as they head into their final group game is, will Vladko Ananovski use the same starting 11 that he used for the first two games? And how much of a role will Rose Lavelle play? Because once again, we saw her coming off the bench in the second half against the Netherlands, and she had an instant impact. But she also picked up a knock after colliding with Danielle van der Donk. So that's definitely one to keep an eye on as we head back to Auckland.
A United States 1-1 draw against the Dutch drew nearly 8 million viewers, making it the largest combined English and Spanish language audience for a group stage match involving the American women. The night's top play is all about the work done on the diamond, and this season no one's done it better than Shohei. Kevin Winter has the details.
Number 4.
Jim, all the top sound Thursday night comes from the diamond, including on the south side in Chicago where the Guardians and White Sox opened up a 4-game weekend series. Cleveland got off to the good start on WTIM 1100.
Breaking ball, tap back to the mound, and on through. It trickles into shallow center after hitting the second base bag. Scoring is Jimenez, and racing to second with a hustle double on a dribbler back through the box is Josh Naylor. 5-3 Cleveland.
Number 3.
Jim, the hottest team in baseball is the Chicago Cubs. No, I have not started drinking, I promise. They have now won 6 in a row, given their victory in St. Louis Thursday night. Pat Hughes with the call of this Mike Tauchman solo home run of the 6th on the Cubs Radio Network.
Tauchman drives one in the air, deep right center, going back toward the track. Near the wall is Jordan Walker, and that ball is going to be gone. Home run, right center, Mike Tauchman. Cubs now lead 7-1.
Number 2.
But Jim, the story from Thursday around Major League Baseball is arguably the best day individually that a player has had in the history of the game. Game 1 of a doubleheader, Angels and Tigers. Terry Smith will take us home on Angels Radio AM 830.
And the 3-1 pitch. And this is lifted high in the air. It's hit well into center field, but making the running catch about 7 or 8 feet from the rim of the track is the center fielder Mickey Moniak. And Shohei Ohtani has done it today in Detroit. His first major league shutout as Ohtani wins his 9th game of the season.
Number 1.
And now game 2 of the doubleheader, Angels and Tigers. Shohei Ohtani joins Babe Ruth as the only players ever to pitch a shutout in game 1 of a doubleheader and then start as a non-position player in game 2. So what does Ohtani do? Terry, take it home.
Here's the next delivery, and Shohei lifts a high fly ball. It's hit well out into left center, and that one is out of here. Boy, oh boy, this Thursday afternoon in Detroit has been showtime as Ohtani connects 37th home run of the season. Here's Shohei swinging and lifting another ball high and deep, and that one is in right center, and that one is gone. Ohtani with a two-homer game right now. He has 38 for the season.
Amazing, amazing season he has had. We know he won't be dealt, but there are others that will be before the deadline. Bust are only talking Major League Baseball this morning on ESPN Radio, 7:45 Eastern, joining Harry Douglas and Amber Wilson. There's NFL conversation, Mike Tenenbaum on at 7 Eastern, while Marcel Louis-Jacques talking Dolphins at 8:30 Eastern. Cowboys quarterback Dak Prescott, a league-high 15 INTs a season ago, says, yeah, that has to stop.
I'm not going to stop being aggressive. 10 or tipped, whatever you say it is. I am going to lessen my interception numbers. That is a guaranteed.
Jerry Jones agrees.
What last year represented relative to turnovers was unexpected. I expect to see what we expect from Dak, which is don't turn the ball over and be protective of the ball, which is what he really, when I think of Dak, that's the first thing that comes to my mind. That's what he does good.
Breanna Stewart, 25 of her 33 in the first half as the Liberty beat the Dream. Coming up, Shohei shines two times over. That's next. This is SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio.
Yo, it's Jay Williams coming up on Friday. As we head into the last weekend before the MLB trade deadline, I'll tell you which stars should be on the move. Don't miss it. 6 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Radio, ESPN2, and ESPNU.
The top headlines are next on SportsCenter All Night.
TuneIn's exclusive Soul Groove puts the groove in your day, bringing you the soulful classics of the 70s, 80s, and 90s, all day long, around the clock. Marvin Gaye, Stevie Wonder, Whitney Houston, and more of the artists you love, bringing the soul to all your devices. Get your groove on now. Just search Soul Groove on TuneIn to listen.
Wall Street Journal Radio is now on TuneIn. From top-line morning briefings to afternoon deep dives on the markets, the economy, and more, invest in your day with WSJ Radio.
I'm J.R. Whalen for the Wall Street Journal. Many workers have high expectations for raises.
Discover business news and analysis for the decisions that matter from sources you can trust. The Wall Street Journal, Barron's, MarketWatch, and Investor's Business Daily. It's all here, now streaming on TuneIn. Search Wall Street Journal Radio on TuneIn to listen.
I'm World Cup champion Megan Klingenberg. Wondering who you should root for at the FIFA Women's World Cup? I'm hosting a new podcast, My New Favorite Futbolista, where I will introduce you to soccer's brightest stars and the causes they are championing. From the 22-year-old American phenom speaking out about student-athlete mental health,
I try to just like approach everything with like you don't know what someone's going through,
to the U.S. defender who travels to tournaments with her young son.
Am I ever going to be able to run for 5 minutes straight?
Listen to My New Favorite Futbolista.
TuneIn's Poolside Station is your one-stop shop for pool party playlists. And now you can keep those good vibes going uninterrupted by going commercial-free. It's as easy as signing up for a TuneIn Premium plan. Then, you'll be pumping Diplo, Purple Disco Machine, Disclosure, and more through your speakers with absolutely no ads. With TuneIn Premium, the party never stops. Just upgrade today to get started.
And a curveball smacked into left center field.
As a sports fan, you know action. And TuneIn is here to bring you all the action. From nonstop live sports coverage from the biggest leagues.
Ovechkin with a steal. Chance here on the break-in. Kuznetsov fires. Scores!
To in-depth podcasts on what's going on with your favorite teams. And all the game-changing content in between.
Randall, step back three. Bang!
TuneIn is the playbook for sports fans.
Did you know you can use AirPlay and Chromecast to listen on connected devices? Tap on the device icon from the now playing screen on the TuneIn app and listen to all your favorite stations like today's hits.
I can buy myself flowers.
Latin hits, country roads, and more.
Hi, we're the Goo Goo Dolls. We're fortunate that our daughters have what they need to grow and learn. But that isn't the case for nearly 13 million kids in the U.S. that struggle with hunger.
Childhood hunger is a heartbreaking reality that Feeding America is working to change. Each year, the Feeding America network of food banks rescues billions of pounds of good food that would have gone to waste and provides it to families and children in need.
You can help kids in need in your community by visiting feedingamerica.org.
Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Next time on the New Yorker Radio Hour, the biographer of atomic scientist Robert Oppenheimer, the subject of Christopher Nolan's new film.
He feared that if the war ended without the use of this weapon, the next war was going to be fought by two nuclear armed adversaries, and it would be Armageddon.
Oppenheimer's biographer Kai Bird, next time on the New Yorker Radio Hour. Listen to this episode of the New Yorker Radio Hour on TuneIn today.
Hi, I'm Danica Patrick. Watching my nieces grow, play, and learn is amazing, but not every child gets to be carefree. One in six kids in the U.S. are hungry.
SportsCenter All Night. Shohei shows out in the Angels doubleheader.
Shohei Ohtani has done it today in Detroit. His first major league shutout as Ohtani wins his ninth game of the season.
Joe Burrow gets carted off the practice field.
This is a team that is set to challenge the Kansas City Chiefs once again in the AFC for supremacy. And without Joe Burrow, that's an impossibility.
Sala claps back at Sean Payton.
Just say we got to get better as an organization because we weren't that good last year. We stunk up the place. You don't have to mention his name. You don't have to mention the New York Jets.
Plus, Dolphin star goes down in practice. The unit doesn't completely fall apart without Jalen Ramsey. But let's also not get it twisted. There is no replacing a Jalen Ramsey.
And the Buffs say see you later to the Pac-12.
We feel strongly moving forward that the stability in the Big 12 will give us the platform we need to have success in the future.
This is SportsCenter All Night.
Well, I'm not going to acknowledge Sean on that. It's, you know, he's been in the league a while. He can say whatever the hell he wants. But as far as, you know, what we have going on here, I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping.
Here's Jim Basquiat.
On a day his new coach stands up to the Arrows, Aaron Rodgers might be showing his worth to the Jets before taking a regular season snap and encouraging news concerning Bronny James. Welcome to SportsCenter All Night on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. ESPN Radio is presented by Progressive Insurance. It's the time of year where training camps are just getting underway in the NFL, while Major League Baseball is nearing its trade deadline, where teams have to hold them or fold them. The Angels are clearly the former, pushing all their chips to the center of the table.
Shohei Ohtani, his first major league shutout. Fly ball, it's hit well out into left center, and that one is out of here. This Thursday afternoon in Detroit has been showtime.
Yeah, by now you know the Angels are not dealing pending free agent Shohei Ohtani, with GM Perry Minasian saying, we are going to roll the dice and see what happens. What happened on Thursday was pretty special, as baseball's best player again showed why on the mound and with the bat.
Here's the next delivery, and Shohei lifts a high fly ball. It's hit well out into left center, and that one is out of here. Boy, oh boy, this Thursday afternoon in Detroit has been showtime as Ohtani connects 37th home run of the season. Here's Shohei swinging and lifting another ball high and deep, and that one is in right center, and that one is gone. Ohtani with a two-homer game right now. He has 38 for the season.
Yeah, that was game two against the Tigers. Ohtani hitting two home runs to increase his major league leading total to 38, clearing the fences a pair of times in an 11-4 win before leaving the game with cramps. In the opener, he got the ball on the mound, and finished what he started.
And the 3-1 pitch. And this is lifted high in the air. It's hit well into center field, but making the running catch about 7 or 8 feet from the rim of the track is the center fielder, Mickey Moniak. And Shohei Ohtani has done it today in Detroit. His first major league shutout as Ohtani wins his 9th game of the season.
The calls on Angels Radio AM 830. Ohtani threw a one-hit shutout. His first complete game in the bigs as the Angels beat the Tigers 6-0 in what amounted to a doubleheader sweep fueled by Ohtani. He became the first major league player to throw a shutout in one game of a doubleheader, hit a home run, much less two, in the other. His skipper, Phil Nevin, on what it impresses him so much about his star.
You know, we try to not to take it for granted what we have in him. You hate to say that, like, you expect greatness every day, just because, but it's what we get, and it's awesome to watch. The thing is that him performing at this level, when there's so much focus on one person to be great and continue to be great as he does, only the mentally strong are able to do that, and that's what impresses me most about him. So, I mean, obviously you guys talk about him every day, and it's on TV every day, and the fans come to see him every day, and to still be able to perform the way he does, it's mind-boggling, the mental toughness that he has to be able to do this.
Yes, they know their two-way superstar is a free agent with no guarantees he'll re-sign with the Angels, but they sent a message not only to their fans but their players, specifically Ohtani, that they are in a win-now mode after acquiring right-handers Lucas Giolito and Ronaldo Lopez from the White Sox. Their GM on that message.
It's just, as far as messages go, I just think it's improving the roster, which I've tried to do since I've gotten here. So, you know, we feel like there's an opportunity to win and to play well going forward. And we're going to roll the dice and see what happens.
Yeah, and Aldin Gonzalez on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on the Angels' chances to keep them this postseason.
I know there are a lot of people from the outside that completely discount the Angels' chances of bringing him back, and I understand why. I mean, this is a franchise that, even though they've had two generational players in Mike Trout and Shohei Ohtani, haven't done any meaningful winning in a really long time. So it's easy to see why you'd be skeptical, but the Angels feel like they have a chance. They feel like they have a chance because of his familiarity with the organization, because they helped him. They helped groom him into becoming a successful two-way player because they give him so much autonomy. He basically does whatever he wants. He runs his own program. And just the comfort of playing for the Angels, I'm not saying that that's going to sway him in free agency, especially when so many teams are going to be committing so much money to sign him. But they feel like at the very least, they have a chance, or more of a chance than maybe people on the outside believe they might have.
Yeah, and keep this in mind. They've won 9 of 11 games, aiming for their first playoff appearance since 2014. They're expecting to get Mike Trout back, and he and their skipper, Phil Nevin, all about going for it, which may not only be good for the Angels, but also good for the game of baseball.
Yeah, it's exciting. I mean, I think it's a different buzz in the room today, and obviously it helps us quite a bit. I mean, two quality arms and established starter that's, you know, at the top of a lot of rotations. But really the buzz in the room and the feeling, you know, in the front office when the ownership is really bought into what we've got here, believes in us, believes in the players, the staff, it's a great feeling to have.
Been saying it since the beginning of the year, you know, the front office wants to win. You see the Perry's working some magic over there, and you know, Artie's, you know, agreeing with it. So it's a good message for the guys. You know, message has been the same all year. We're in it till, you know, we're not. So it's going to keep pushing forward, see how it goes.
Bengals quarterback Joe Burrow was carted off the practice field today after what appeared to be a non-contact injury.
These things can range from days to multiple weeks.
You have to wonder if we'll see Burrow again before his name gets signed.
Yeah, concerning news of the Bengals as QB Joe Burrow carted off the practice field Thursday, came up hobbling from a scramble. The franchise signal caller on one leg as he went to the ground with a play near the end of their afternoon practice. He was wearing a sleeve on it and limping. Coach Zach Taylor said later it was a calf injury. Here's more from the Bengals coach.
This is football. Guys go down with an injury that maybe is a day thing. Who knows? So we don't message the team after every single person goes down. There's a lot of guys that had soreness today. To have reps cut down a little bit. So that's just part of playing football in training
camp. Yeah, source telling ESPN's Ben Baby that an early assessment indicates it's a calf strain. WCPO-TV's Caleb Noe on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on the initial reaction when Burrow went down.
You see that guy and the face of the franchise go down. You talk about a hush over the practice facility. You can, it kind of went in waves because it's a large, there's like two full football fields side by side there. So some of the fans are, I mean, you're talking 75 yards away from where it happened, but you could tell that slowly it kind of worked its way around and people realized Joe Burrow is on the ground and he's getting, being put on a cart and being carted off the field. What I will remember about right after it happened was there was somebody behind me and they were screaming, no, 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 because like people understand what this guy's been to, but they also understand what he means to this organization and the franchise and the team.
ESPN injury analyst Stefania Bell on Canny and Carlin.
So you really need to get specifics on the degree of injury when you start talking timetables. And that's something we just can't tell from a distance. But, you know, he definitely felt a pretty good pull there. But these things can range from days, 5 to 7 days for a mild injury, to multiple weeks if it's something more severe.
Again, keep in mind, Burrow in contract discussions with the Bengals on a deal that could make him the highest paid player in the league. Ryan Clark on NFL Live.
If Coach Taylor is correct and it's a calf injury, then both Joe Burrow and the Cincinnati Bengals are so lucky. But when you're somebody like Joe, who is on the precipice of the largest contract in football history, in NFL history, not just for the position, but in total, you're scared. You want to make sure that you're healthy. And if you're the Cincinnati Bengals, you want to make sure your franchise player is ready to go going forward. But for the immediate, this is a team that is set to challenge the Kansas City Chiefs once again in the AFC for supremacy. And without Joe Burrow, that's an impossibility.
Along those lines, Adam Schefter on what we can expect regarding Burrow on the field.
The backdrop to all this, of course, is that Joe Burrow is on the verge of becoming the highest paid player in NFL history. At some point, the two sides are going to try to get that deal done. And you have to wonder now, with Joe Burrow's agent also representing Nick Bosa, who didn't even show to the 49ers training camp and won't show until he gets a new contract, if we won't see Joe Burrow back on a practice field again until he does become the highest paid player in NFL history. But for now, it looks like a calf injury. Calf injuries usually sideline players multiple weeks, but mixed in with the backdrop of his unsettled contract situation, you have to wonder if we'll see Burrow again before his name gets signed.
As far as, you know, what we have going on here, I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping. So hate away. Obviously, we're doing something right if you got to talk about us when we don't play you till week four.
Sean Payton's not shy about letting people know how he feels about things. If he gets asked a question, he's going to answer it bluntly. And I think that's what he was doing while also sending a message to everybody within his organization about what the culture is going to be moving forward.
For a guy like Sean Payton, it was a small move by him. You don't have to mention his name. You don't have to mention the New York Jets.
Yeah, Broncos head coach Sean Payton unleashing criticisms on his predecessor, Nathaniel Hackett, and his new team, Hackett's new team, the New York Jets. In an interview with the USA Today Sports, Payton called the work done by Hackett and his staff in 2022 one of the worst coaching jobs in the history of the NFL. Broncos went 5-12 in Russell Wilson's first season in Denver. He had a career worst season, including just 16 touchdowns and a league-high 55 sacks. Payton also took aim at Hackett's new employer, the New York Jets, saying they are spending a lot of time trying to win the offseason with a lot of pomp and circumstance, to which Jets coach Robert Saleh responded.
Well, I'm not going to acknowledge Sean on that. It's, you know, he's been in the league a while. He can say whatever the hell he wants. But as far as, you know, what we have going on here, I kind of live by saying, if you ain't got no haters, you ain't popping. So hate away. Obviously, we're doing something right if you got to talk about us when we don't play you till week four. You know, the guys in our locker room, they've earned everything that's coming to them and really excited about what's going on. I think Hackett's doing a phenomenal job here. The coaching staff is doing a phenomenal job, and we're focused on us. I get it. There's a lot of external noise. There's a lot of people who are hating on us. There's a lot of people looking for us to fail. There's a lot of crows pecking at our neck. But all you can do is spread your wings, keep flying high until those crows fall off and suffocate from the inability to breathe. But really, really, really excited about the group we have, the coaching that's going on, and But I'm going to keep our focus on us and making sure that we're prepared every single day to do the best we can. And